Tonight, page number 216, I'm dwelling in Beulah Land. It's so good to see you in church tonight. I appreciate you being here. And we're going to sing first, second, and fourth verses together tonight. The best way to worship the Lord together is for everybody to sing together. So let's lift our voices, if you will, and join along the choir. When we get on that chorus, the men are going to say, praise God. Ladies, you can say it too if you want to. Let's sing this together, if you will. Sunday night service. And I want to start off the service by saying welcome again. Thank you for being here. And I want to apologize to this side over here. If they fall asleep, it's not their fault, okay? It's dark over there and our lights are flickering here. We got to get some bulbs changed out, so we've got those turned off so we don't have a seizure or something like that tonight. But bear with us if you will. We appreciate your patience on that. So we miss our pastor tonight. We always do when he's not here. And boy, I'm thankful that another church wants to hear him preach, amen? And we love to hear him preach. And if you were here this morning, you know the Lord really used him to speak to hearts and certainly spoke to my heart. So thank the Lord for our pastor. And we want to go to the Lord in prayer tonight. I'm going to ask Brother Matt Honey to come pray for us tonight. And we're going to start the service off with prayer. And Brother Matt, you come on if you will. So let's remember our pastor tonight in prayer. He mentioned the prayer requests this morning, so we're not going to go over those again, and you've got those in the bulletin, and we'll get through some announcements and so forth in just a little while. But you pray for the service tonight. I said to the choir before we started the service, I know things are a little out of sync when the pastor's not here, but we don't want this just to be another Sunday night service, right? We want to leave differently than what we came in, and I know the Lord has given Brother Randy Wall a message for us tonight. And so we just want to open our hearts to what the Lord has for us. You pray along there in your seat as Brother Matt leads us to the Lord in prayer. And then right after he leads us in prayer, the choir will sing another song.
All right, let's pray together. Our Father, Lord, we want to thank you so much. We can be back in church again tonight, Lord. We want to thank you for God's people and the blessing it is to be a child of God and to have a place to belong. And I want to thank you for Temple Baptist Church and for the good people here. And Lord, I pray, Lord, that church is good because we know that God is good. And I want to thank you for being so good to me and for blessing me with the way you have. And God, I pray that you might bless our people tonight. Lord, we're a needy folk. And God, we have so many burdens and so many things to pray about. And I just pray, God, that you bless and meet each need, God, according to your will. And I pray, God, that you'll meet with us tonight. God, bless Brother Wall as he brings the word of God. And Lord, I'm very thankful for Brother Wall and what he means to me in my life. And God, I pray, Lord, that you just give him a message, God, that's going to help us. Bless the choir, God, tonight as they sing for us. And Lord, we miss our pastor and his family. And God, I pray that you be with him and give him power as he preaches tonight. And I pray, Lord, that you bring him back to us safely, Lord, again on Wednesday night. And Lord, we just want to thank you, God, once again for your many, many blessings. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
All right, I'm going to give Brother Matt time. I asked him to pray, and he's got to run the sound at the same time. It's hard to be in two places at one time. But the choir is going to sing tonight, Sweet Hour of Prayer. I hope it'll be a blessing to you.
Sweet hour of prayer,
you love that old song. Amen. Thank the Lord for the privilege to pray. We're going to ask you to stand with us one more time tonight, and we're going to sing together page number 65, Jesus Keep Me Near the Cross. Page 65, we'll sing first and last verses together. That last verse together tonight. Tonight, remain standing if you will. The ushers are going to come. We're going to receive our offering tonight. I caught you. Some of them were about to sit down. I think we probably normally do, and I'm sorry about that. But we're going to receive our offering tonight. I want to encourage you to give tonight if you weren't able to give this morning, and be a part of this way to worship the Lord. And tithing, giving is a way to worship God. And out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. And also where our heart is, or where our treasure is, there will our heart be also. So let's give tonight. If you can't give tonight, you can give online. And you can go to our church website and give on there. So let's have a word of prayer tonight. And then after prayer, you can be seated. And then I think Violet and Bridget are going to have an instrumental for us tonight during the offering. And I know that'll be a blessing for you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the privilege to be here again tonight. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity you've given us to be in your house with your people. Lord, what a special time. What a special day. We thank you, Lord, for establishing the church. Lord, we thank you for encouraging us, for challenging us, for commanding us to be a part of a local assembly, and Lord, to assemble together. Lord, I pray that you'll help us tonight. Once again, we ask you for your filling, for your power throughout the rest of this service. Lord, all is vain unless the Holy Spirit of God comes down and you meet with us, Lord, and we're asking you to do that. I ask you to move in hearts, speak to my heart. Lord, many of us are going to go out tomorrow. We're going to go into a lost and dying world, and we're going into workplaces and, Lord, places of business, and, Lord, even in the marketplaces, Lord, wherever we are, people need you as their personal Savior. I pray that you'll give us strength, Lord, to be a light. Lord, I pray that you would help us to be salt and light in this lost and dying world. It's uncomfortable. It's uncomfortable for a lost world to see light, but I pray that you'll help us, Lord, to be strong, to be bold, to proclaim the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray that you'll be with our pastor tonight, Lord. I ask that you would keep your hand on him. He may be preaching as we speak. I'm not sure, but God, I pray that you'd fill him with your power. I thank you, Lord, for sending him to Temple Baptist Church to be our under-shepherd, Lord, to be the one that leads us and guides us as a flock. Lord, I pray that you'll help us to continue to stand behind him and support him, Lord. I thank you for the love that he has for our church and for this people. And then, Lord, I pray for this offering tonight. I pray that you'll bless the gift, Lord, and bless those who are able to give and those who are not able to give tonight, Lord. And bless the remainder of this service in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Ladies, I appreciate that. Bridget has just got that violin. I would say it's new. It's not new. She bought it from somebody. And that violin, Bridget, is old, right? 100 years old. Beautiful tone to that violin. So that's awesome. And thank you so much, Violet, for playing for us tonight as well. And that's certainly a blessing. I appreciate these young ladies using their talents for the Lord. Amen? So, I've got quite a few announcements tonight, so you hang on. I know you have listened well. It gets a little monotonous to listen to the same person over and over again, but I'll try to keep this lively for you tonight, okay? Let's celebrate. So I want to go over birthdays and anniversaries. This is a good time to celebrate tonight, and we have a ton of them on here, so listen carefully. What I'm going to do is I'm going to call these out, and then at the very end, we'll give everybody a hand all at one time. Because if we do it in between, we're going to be clapping a whole lot here, okay? So first birthday that's on the list tonight, Daniel Holly. His birthday is tomorrow, the 22nd. So congratulations to Daniel. I think he'll be half a century old. That's me. That's not him. Half of a half, all right? So he'll be 25 tomorrow. So we'll praise the Lord for Daniel. And then Luther Kane has a birthday tomorrow as well on the 22nd. So congratulations to Luther. And then Tim Andrews' birthday on the 24th. So, again, a lot of birthdays going on this coming week. Wilma Seeley, birthday on the 25th. So congratulations to Wilma. And then Grady Hagee, his birthday is on the 25th as well. And then Preston Knight, birthday on the 26th. I think they were not able to be here today, but congratulations to Preston. Happy birthday to him. And then Virginia Botsford, birthday on the 26th. Happy birthday to Virginia. And then Charlie Bull, happy birthday on the 26th of this week as well. So as I said, a lot of birthdays here. And then let's go over anniversaries. Anniversaries this week. Jay and Laura Staley, their anniversary is on the 21st. They're probably watching online tonight. So congratulations to Jay and Laura. Not sure how long they've been married. Congratulations to them. And then Robert and Martha Church, their anniversary is on the 23rd. All right, and they are here tonight. Robert, Martha, would y'all stand for us, please? All right, how long y'all been married? How many? 53. I'm not even that old, brother. 53 years, huh? Praise the Lord. Congratulations to them. Let's go ahead and give them a hand. That's wonderful tonight. Robert and Martha Church, they are such a blessing to our church, and they're so sweet. Salt of the earth. We talk about people sometimes that are just salt of the earth people, and they are that kind of people. We praise the Lord for them. And then Steve and Penny Carlton, anniversary on the 26th of this week. Is that not right? 24th. Okay, thank you. The 24th. I'm glad you're here tonight to correct that. So you've got a $1,000 check for my wife and I that's coming on the 26th, so I just be expecting that, all right? Praise the Lord. So happy anniversary to you two. And how long y'all been married? 37. Praise the Lord. 37 years. Let's give them a hand as well tonight. All right, and then let's go back. All these birthdays that are coming up this week, a lot of these folks are not here tonight, but let's give all these a hand for the birthdays tonight as well. And August is a big month for birthdays. September's better. That's coming up soon, all right? So praise the Lord for that. All right, I've got quite a few announcements here. I'm just going to jump in this and go through these as quickly as possible. But don't forget about our Wednesday night service. Amen. We always enjoy our Wednesday night services. Of course, Kids for Truth program will be going on. And then our teen program over in the Genesis building. And don't forget about that, young people. And then we have outreach at 5:30. And then, of course, supper before that starting at 5 o'clock. Our meal is from 5 to 6:45. And so we need to get a count tonight. If you were planning on coming to the meal this coming Wednesday night between 5 and 6:45, would you please stand? And I'm going to try to get a count quickly here. If you're planning on coming to the meal, we certainly enjoy this time together. I'm going to be quiet and count. Awkward silence. All right, I got it, got it. Thank you so much for standing tonight. 33, Miss Kelly. So that will be our meal on this coming Wednesday night. If you can make it for outreach, I encourage you to come and be a part of that. And just this is a special time that we can get together and go out. Some of us load up on a van. Some of us get in cars. And we just go out in the neighborhood. It's never too far away from here. And just visit folks. Some people knock on doors. Some people just hang door hangers. But whatever you can do, you want to do for the Lord, of course, and do it for the right reason. Let's reach out into our community and invite folks to come to church. I truly believe that there are times that we can witness to people door to door, and the Holy Spirit's prepared them, and we have the opportunity to witness to them. But I also truly believe that if we can get lost people into the house of God, God is going to give our pastor a message, and the Lord is going to be able to speak to their hearts. And so we want to just love on them. So be a part of that if you can't. If you cannot, then, of course, take an outreach card, and you can pass those out in different places as well. Want everybody to be a part of that. Upcoming events, our diaper drop-off over here for Hunter and Abby Pendry. That'll be today and next week, so don't forget if you have those diapers to drop those off over here. That will be a great, tremendous blessing to them. And then this Thursday, August the 25th, our summer ladies meeting at 7 p.m. The theme of that is Let's Flamingo. And we do have a sign-up sheet out here. If you've not already signed up, ladies, for that ladies meeting, you do want to get signed up tonight so that they can prepare for that. And of course, they'll be setting up this week, and they need to know how many people are coming. And Miss Jennifer White will be coming to speak for that, and I know that will be a tremendous blessing for our ladies. All right? Then I'm really excited about our church picnic and cornhole tournament. That's coming up on Saturday, September the 17th. That will be a great time. Here's what we're asking you to do. You don't have to sign up for the picnic or the cornhole. Well, you do need to sign up for the cornhole tournament. All right, if you're going to be participating in that, find a partner and sign up so we can get teams together. We also need you to sign up for food, okay? You don't have to sign up if you're just coming, but we need you to sign up for food for that. Those sign-up sheets are out here in the vestibule, so please remember that, if you will, and sign up on your way out tonight. And then next Sunday afternoon, we have deacons meeting at 4 o'clock, men. Deacons meeting at 4 o'clock because at 5 o'clock, we have a leadership meeting with our pastor. Anybody who is in a leadership position that does any kind of teaching, regardless of age group in our church, pastor needs to meet with all of us next Sunday afternoon at 5 o'clock and just go over some things, make sure everybody's on the same page. It's important that we do this and make sure that everybody is on the same page and in one accord and unison in what we're trying to do and teach here. So again, that'll be next Sunday, August the 28th at 5 p.m., and there'll be info on that in the bulletin that should be in there today. All right? And then Super September, we're looking forward to this time of meetings, and September is almost here. And so we'll be starting that on Tuesday night, the first Tuesday night in September. And we're looking forward to this series of meetings every Tuesday night in the month of September. This is just a reminder again, we don't have service on Wednesday nights, it's on Tuesday nights. Also, Kids for Truth and the teens will be over here for those meetings. So just remember that, if you will. There'll be no team meetings for the month of September as we're having these special meetings here in the church auditorium. Also, for Super September, there will be a meal meeting after service tonight. Not a meal, a meal meeting after service tonight, all right, with Miss Kelly. And so don't forget about that. Where do you want to meet with them, Miss Kelly? All right, just over here in front of the organ section. That'll be just fine. So that meal meeting after service tonight, if you are able to participate in that, please make sure you meet with her and they can get all that information together. All right, last announcement that we have, and then we're going to have a special song. And then after that special song, I'll introduce our special speaker tonight. But teens, don't forget about our upcoming youth activity. That'll be Saturday, September the 10th. That's a nacho bar and a scavenger hunt. We're looking forward to a great time together with our teenagers. They are such a blessing to us. And we're looking forward to that time also, not this Wednesday night, but next Wednesday night, the last Wednesday of the month of August, will be pizza night. The teens will be over in the Genesis building the whole time, and then Micah will be speaking that night for teen night, so you don't want to miss that and be a part of it. All right? Miss Kelly Honey has done such a great job tonight. We appreciate her filling in with Miss Hannah not being here, and she's going to sing our special song for us tonight, and then right after that, I'll introduce our speaker for tonight.
Thank the Lord for saving me tonight. If you can't tell, my family, we love the old hymns. And so I'm going to sing Rock of Ages tonight. I know we all know it, but sometimes with the older songs, you know, we just like recite them and we don't think about them. So just listen to the words tonight. Don't listen to me playing. Don't listen to my voice. Just listen to the words and let the Lord move. Me
you so much. Miss Kelly, beautiful song tonight. Appreciate that old hymn, and performed well tonight as well. Thank you so much. Somebody once said, it's amazing, and I'm not quoting this just right, but it's amazing what the Lord can do with someone who is totally sold out to the Lord Jesus Christ. Just totally sold out, have given their heart to the Lord. And boy, that's the desire that we have, of course, for ourselves, but it's a desire my wife and I have for our young people. And we tell them often that how happy we are being in the ministry. Being in the ministry is not a drudgery. It's not something we feel like we have to do. It's something we love. And we've been in the ministry for years, and we thank God for enabling us and putting us into the ministry. But one such person is Brother Randy Wall, and I'm not going to belabor this tonight, but Brother Randy is my friend. And he's the older you get, the more you understand the list of your friends grow smaller and smaller, right? True friends, they grow smaller and smaller. That's just the way life is. But Brother Randy and I met quite a few years back, and our hearts were just knit. There's just something about Brother Randy. You can talk to him and his wife, Pam, and feel like you've just known them all their life, and they have kindred spirits, and they love the Lord. And Brother Randy is just sold out. He's devoted just to give his life to the Lord Jesus Christ and to preach the Word of God. He's not just my friend, but he's a friend to our pastor, and he's a friend to this church. And Brother Randy, I want to say tonight, thank you for being our friend. We appreciate it. Would you come and preach for us tonight, and then I'll close out the service this evening.
I'm always glad if I can get up here without falling on those two steps. But as you get older, you get more glad. Is that proper English?
Yes, sir.
It is in Surrey County, where I grew up. I don't know about Forsyth, but I got a lot more worser than that. Good to see you. Evidently, Brother Josh didn't tell you I was coming. And you definitely didn't know Pam wasn't going to be here, or you wouldn't have shown up for sure. But please pray for Pam. She is so, so sick with peripheral vertigo. Anybody ever had that? Bless her heart. I mean, she got up yesterday morning at 7. She was fine. At 7:30, she was in the bathroom floor, just, we used to call it puking. That's another Surrey County term, throwing up, regurgitating. It all sounds nasty, don't it? It is. Amen. I didn't know who had the worst end, her or me holding the bucket. But it was her. And we didn't know what she had, but I took her to the emergency room about 6:30 yesterday evening, and Lord worked it out. Well, one of our good friends was on duty there. She's an NP, and I text her, and she said, I'm up front tonight, come on. And man, we just went right back, and they had her IVs hooked up in 15 minutes and was getting her some help. And I was reminded of how blessed that I am standing there. She was out in the hallway, the rooms were full, but some of those poor people that came in there. There was a man right across the hall from us who had fallen and broken his hip and was in tremendous pain. And, you know, takes a little while for him to get you any meds. The doctor has to order those. But he was just crying out, Lord, help me, Lord, help me, Lord, help me. I need some help. And another lady right down from us, some pitiful. Folks, we better be glad that we can be here tonight. Because there's so many people that would trade places with us in a moment, health-wise. And sometimes I take that for granted. But it reminded me last night of how good God is to me. Physically, I've expanded my horizons during COVID. COVID ain't going to kill me, I used to say, but COVID fat has got a good start on me, and I can't get rid of it, Brother David. It don't come off as easy at 65 as it did at 35. But if any of y'all got a secret to that that includes eating anything you want, I'm all ears. But it's good to see you tonight. I appreciate Brother Josh letting me come once again. And always be willing to share your pastor with other churches. It's a blessing to the church, it's a blessing to him, and it'll be a blessing to you, because the Lord will bless you for that, for sharing him with other churches, and even though he had to be at Freedom. No, I got a lot of good friends at Freedom Baptist Church, and just like I do here. But thank you for being here tonight. How many of you are here? That's almost everybody. We've got a few absent. I understand that. We're Baptists. And but most of you are here, and we're glad to see you. But do say a prayer for Pam. I would appreciate that much. I just felt, you know, it's hard when you can't help anybody, and you want to help them so bad. But I'm glad they were able to get us some medications and able to get her somewhat comfortable now. And so pray for her. Good to see too my neighbors. Don't ask them nothing about me, because I ain't nothing at home like I am here. I go to the mailbox in my pajamas. At least I don't go to Walmart in my pajamas. A lot of people do, amen. And they don't fix their hair either. I try to stay away from them. You know, can you imagine how their breath smells? Because you know they brushed their teeth if they didn't even take time, Brother Haynes, to take their pajamas off to go to Walmart. But it's good to see them tonight. Psalm 73. If I don't shut up with this foolishness, we won't ever get done. Psalm 73. And this is one of my favorite of many psalms in the Word of God, because I can identify with it. And you say, preacher, what's it about? It's about somebody who's about ready to give up. You ever been in that position? You know, it's like, hey, man, I'm ready to throw in the towel. There's too much going on in life. And it just seemed like I used to think life was going to get more simple as I got older. I got bad news, young folks. It ain't happening. Especially if you have children. Yeah, well, I only have one daughter, three grandsons, four great-grandchildren, I think. at least four, maybe five. I can't remember. I have to count them up. But when my daughter got married, Lord, she's a good daughter. I love her so much, her and her husband, Josh. But when she got married, I told Pam, we got it made. You know, we're home free. We're empty nesters and loving it. No, we just had to start buying two families groceries. Amen. We had three more children to raise. No, she was a good mama. Monica still is. But life does not get simpler as you get older. Remember that. It can get better in some respect because we're closer home if you're a Christian. You've been born again. You're nearer home today than you were yesterday. And reminds me of that old song we sing sometimes. But life is hard. I mean, it's just full of bumps and speed bumps and all these different things. And it doesn't get easier as we get older and things begin to deteriorate and sag in places that it didn't used to sag and all. And all of these things, you know, you look in the mirror and you want to go back to bed. You feel like this man Asaph, who penned this psalm under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. In verse 1 of 73 here, he says, truly God is good to Israel. God's been good to Israel. God's been good to the United States of America. God's still good to the United States of America. Even though I think we're somewhat under the judgment of God for all of our sinful ways and no fear of God, and that's evident in a lot of people's lives in our country. Thank God it's not everybody. You only see the bad part if you watch the news. You don't ever see the good stuff like what's going on in here. Hear about all the good things that Brother Steve was announcing and all the times of fellowship we can have together. You only hear the bad stuff, but God's been good to the United States of America, still is good, and he's good to Israel, and he's going to be even more gooder to them. Amen. He's not done with them. He said, even to such as are of a clean heart. But notice in verse 2, his tone changes. This is the way we do sometimes. But as for me, You know, we see everybody at their best in church. We get all dutied up. You know, you ladies put that makeup on. I'm for it. Amen. Hey, if you had to put enough on to paint a battleship and enough powder to blow it up, go for it. If that's what you need to do. I ain't wearing any. I ain't crossed that bridge yet. You know, whatever you have to do. And but we get older and our bodies fail us, and I've had friends tell me getting old ain't for sissies and all this stuff, and they're right. I used to tell my mom, I'd say, "Mama, I'm getting old," and she said, "No, you're getting older." That means I was already old. She was a very positive person. Pam used to tell, she died with colon cancer, be almost 3 years, it'd be in February, and Pam, she's a very positive person. I'm not sometimes, according to which side of the bed I get up on, like y'all. And Pam, very positive. She always sees the good side of everything, Brother Steve, and all that. But I'm not like that. And so I wished I could be for that. But I'm like Asaph is in verse 2. But as for me, Lord, we see everybody in here. We come in here and we got everything all fixed up, and we got our Sunday duds on, and you know, we put on them fake Alpana smiles. You know, people say, "How you doing, brother?" "Oh, I'm doing great. How are you?" And you rant and raved all the way to church. Fussed and tore your wife's leg off, leaving the driveway because you wouldn't give her time to get her foot in the door. You know, isn't it easy being, you know, used to, I've heard stories about people who have 6 or 8 children. You know, man sit out in the car and blow the horn while she's getting all of them ready. Sure, just shot him right on the spot. God forgive him for that, you know, amen. God forgive you for that type. Be like that one, somebody asked the preacher's wife, said, "You ever thought about divorce?" She said, "No, but I thought about murder a lot of times." So that might be you. Real encouraging for these newly married couples here. Y'all just wait. But as for me, my feet were almost gone. My steps had well nigh, he gets personal, don't he? I'm empty. You ever get like that in life? And hey, guess what? Sometimes I don't feel like going to church. I'm going to be honest. Y'all lie if you want to. Sometimes I don't feel like going to church, you know. I'm not in the mood to go to church. I'm not in the mood to fellowship. I don't want to be nice. Amen. I got up wanting to be ill and enjoying it. Y'all got up like that some mornings too. Amen. Get up, man, I'm mad today. I can't wait for the first person to say anything out of the way to me. I'm going to let them have it. Give them peace of my mind. Talking about them being married 53 years and 37, was it? Back here, we've been married 47 years. I've learned a few things. I hadn't learned when to keep my mouth shut yet. But the doctor was out talking to Pam, and they were checking to make sure she hadn't had a mini stroke or something like that, and they did a CT scan of her head, and the doctor said, "Well, we did, everything came back good. Your brain looks normal." I didn't say anything. I've learned a few things in 47 years. I didn't say nothing. But it gets personal. Verse 3 said, "I was envious at the prosperity of the wicked." Kind of paraphrasing there. There are no bands in their death. You see, he's like we are when we come to church. We only see the good side of everything. And you say, "Well, I wish my family was like yours." No, you don't. You don't have to live with me. You don't have my kin people. Amen. Hey, we come in here and think, "Well, I wish I..." No, you don't. They're just as miserable as you are. Hopefully not. He was envious. He saw the prosperity of the... He didn't... But, and I'm going to skip over and just give you that verse 17. And none of what I'm talking about has anything to do with the message. Isn't that encouraging? Miss Tyndall 7. But I'll just give you some points real quick. And I promise you, we'll get out of here before 7:30 in the morning. Amen. No, we'll get out in a timely manner. But he said in verse 17, "Until I went into the sanctuary." Then understood I their end, the wicked. Not that I revel in it, not that I'm glad that they're going to burn in a lake of fire, not that I'm glad they're going to have to stand before the judgment seat of God and the great white throne judgment and be cast into the lake of fire, the second death. Not glad about any of that, but hey, can I remind us here tonight, this is the worst that we'll ever have it as a child of God. This right here is the worst we'll ever have it. Sitting in an air-conditioned building at Temple Baptist Church, amen, getting ready to go home and eat peanut butter and crackers and drink Mountain Dews. That's the worst we'll ever have it right here. And this ain't too bad, is it? Y'all, man, all y'all do is eat around here. I like it. You said, sign up for food. Is that to bring it or to take it home? If it's to take it home, I'm signing up. Where's the list? I'm signing up for a ham and and a coconut cake, and I'm signing up for that food, amen. But no, this is the worst we'll ever have as the children of God. Let's not forget that. Turn off Fox News. Turn off CNN. Turn off MSNBC. Turn off the bad news on the radio. And remember what the word of the Lord said when he said, when I went into the house of God, then I understood. God brought to my remembrance how wonderful he is to me and how great it's going to be in heaven, amen, when we lay our burdens down. We get a new body that'll never grow old. But if we're not careful, the old flesh and the imps of hell will keep our minds upon the wicked and their seeming prosperity. Seem like they have no problems in death. I got to tell some stories about my mom tonight. She found out she had colon cancer, and she was trying to decide if she wanted to have surgery or not. And so she thought about it for a day or two. The surgeon came back in. And she decided, she said, I'm not going to do it. I'm 80 years old. I've lived my life. I've enjoyed my life. I don't want to go through all of that. And it kind of made the surgeon mad. I guess, you know, ain't no surgeons here tonight, is it? But no, it really did. I was there. It upset him. And he said, I mean, he said something I would have never said to a dying woman, especially my mama. He said, well, you know you're going to die a horrible death, don't you? And Mama, just like that, she said, not if they keep making morphine, I won't. I love it, don't y'all? Not if they keep making morphine, I ain't going to die no horrible death, amen. Like, I had a kidney stone, and I went to the emergency room, and they was giving me shots of Demerol. They'd come back in, they'd give me a shot, come back, how's your pain? I said, look, you just keep giving them till I pass out. Then you'll know I've had enough. When I don't respond, you got it just right. I can understand how you could get addicted to that stuff. It's some good stuff. I mean, it'd put that warm feeling all over your body. You won't care if they take your tonsils out while you're awake. Your goozle and everything else. But it's gonna get better. Now, that's not my message. How many of you ever heard the word omniscient or omniscience? It's one of them eight-cylinder words, you know. I have to look it up, see what it means. But most of us heard about the omnipotence of God, the omnipresence of God, the omniscience of God, which simply means that he has complete and unlimited knowledge. He knows the hairs on our head. He has to do less counting on some than others. But he still knows them, right? He knows the hairs on our head. He knows the beginning from the end. He knows all. And so I believe that. I believe in the omniscience of God and his infinite knowledge. I believe that with all of my heart. I believe the Bible teaches that. So when you hear the title of the message, don't count me a heretic until you hear the first point. And the title of the message, I want to take it from verse 11. Or take my text verse from verse 11 of Psalm 73, where it says, and they say, how doth God know? Is there knowledge in the Most High? You know, there were some of those questions asked in Job. How does God know everything? Does he really know everything? How is it that this Most High being that has that much knowledge. Sometimes people ask me, where did God come from? I say, he didn't come from anywhere because he had no beginning. He didn't come from anywhere. He's always been. I can't comprehend that. But you know what? I got faith enough to believe it. I know he's always existed. I know he's always been. He is now and he always will be. That's the rock that my faith is built on, amen, his son Jesus Christ. But they said, how does God know? Here's their knowledge. And so here's what I'm going to bring to you in the next few minutes, things that God don't know. So wait a minute, I just thought you said God knew everything. Well, let me give you the context of the message, and I hope you'll understand. Number one is this, he doesn't know a sin that he does not hate. God hates all sin. We categorize sin, don't we, based on whether we commit them or not. Amen. I raise my hand. You know, this is bad, murder, drunkenness. And let me say this. The consequences of sin are different physically. Murder has a much greater effect physically and in life than, let's say, telling a lie. Of course, a lie can murder somebody spiritually or mentally. But we're ready to jump on the bandwagon when the preacher is preaching on something that we're not doing. Get him, preacher. Lay it on him. That's right. Tell it like it is. But you let the preacher get in our cornfield and start plowing my patch. And it's like, bless him, Lord. Don't say that, because we know as preachers that we're hitting you. Bless him, Lord. No. But see, we categorize those sins. But hey, there's a lot more sins than murder and abortion and drunkenness and harlotry and all of those things that we hopefully we don't have any problem standing against and realizing is sin. But what about the sin of pride and arrogancy? You know, Brother Steve, I think at one time the Independent Baptist Church got arrogant in the 70s. Maybe some in the 60s. And I think we thought, I was just a kid, but I remember it, we thought we were the only thing going. Now, I agree. I think we're the nearest thing going to the Word of God. Amen, brother. If it wasn't, I wouldn't be an Independent Baptist. But a lot of times people say, you know, somebody say, Brother Matt, I was riding with an officer one day. You'd probably know him if I could remember his name. But I was just doing a ride along one day, and man, he was a professional cusser. I'm not saying all policemen are. But I mean, man, he knew all the words. And for 2 hours, man, he just went blankety blank this. Blank. And so after 2 hours, he said, what do you do? Bad, wrong question. I said, I'm a Baptist preacher. His face turned 14 shades of red. And he said, why didn't you tell me that when you got in the car? I said, because you didn't ask me. Amen. And you know what? He quit cussing. Now, that don't happen much nowadays. People don't have enough respect for the man of God anymore. And women just as bad sometimes. Man, they know all them with them words too, you know. But somebody's, what are you doing? I say, I'm a Baptist preacher. Well, what kind of Baptist? Well, there ain't about 498 kinds. Independent Baptist, Free Will Baptist, Southern Baptist, Lord General Baptist, American Baptist. I mean, you could go on and on. And sometimes I'll say this, I'm a dependent Baptist, dependent on the Lord. Amen. Hey, I'm an Independent Baptist. Sometimes I'm not too proud of that. But I'm more a dependent Baptist, because if we get anything done in this life, it'll have to be because of him. Amen. And we'll have to be dependent on him. and that goes for the Methodists and the Presbyterians and the Moravians and whoever. If anything gets done for God, they'll have to do it God's way, by God's word, in God's time. I think there for a while, I don't know about now, but I mean, I think we got a little arrogant. And I think, you know, God maybe brought us down a notch, because there was a lot of stuff went on on some big independent Baptist churches that some of you could go back and I won't review all of that. But hey, can I say this? Sin is sin. Whether it's a drunkard or a harlot or a murderer or a liar or one who is prideful. How about somebody sowing discord? Don't be sowing discord. There's enough people out there to do that. Don't let your ears be garbage cans for discord. Just say, I don't want to hear it. Just say, hey, look, I don't want. But hey, God doesn't know sin that he don't hate. Number two, he doesn't know a sinner that he doesn't love. Amen. I'm so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves even me. Aren't you glad God loves us? Anybody in here perfect? I've told that old joke here. A preacher asked that question. A man sitting down in the front row said, I do. He said, sir, you know somebody's perfect? He said, yeah, my wife's first husband. You get that after a while. But none of us are perfect, are we? But aren't you glad God don't treat us like we treat each other sometimes? When we expect perfection out of one another and we're nowhere near as perfect ourselves, but hey, God, I'm not excusing sin or trying to say we can do this or do that and because of grace we can get by whatever, like Paul said. God forbid. No, not in any manner, shape, form, or fashion. Hey, we shouldn't. Hey, when you've had the best, why in the world would you want to go back to the hog pen of this world? Amen. When you've had homemade custard banana pudding, what do you want a Cool Whip banana pudding for? Although I like them too. Don't make any enemies when it comes to food. But God, hey, did God love the prodigal son just as much as he did John the Baptist? Yeah. He loved the old prodigal son down there in the hog pen. He was in ruin. He loved the harlot woman at Samaria. She was a reprobate. No morals about her whatsoever. Had five husbands, was shacked up with somebody when Jesus came by. But aren't you glad God loved her? Amen. Aren't you glad God loved me? Oh, yeah. God never known a sinner that he doesn't love. Old Zacchaeus, the rich. God loves rich people. Old Saul, who became Paul. Man of great religion. God loved him. One who murdered Christians and approved of that. So number two, he doesn't know a sinner that he doesn't love. Number three, God don't know how to fail. God don't know how to fail. He ain't never failed. He ever failed you? No, you might think he had, but he ain't. We might get like Asaph in Psalm 73 and said, hey, I've cleansed my heart in vain, he said down there in verse 13. But we ain't cleansed our heart in vain. Why? God ain't never failed nobody. He ain't never lost one of his little children. Ain't nobody ever lost their salvation. I jokingly say sometimes I'll be preaching a meeting and get back, somebody say, how'd your meeting go? I said, man, we had a good meeting. Had three people lost their salvation. And nobody gets saved. I'm just jokingly saying that, y'all. Don't take me serious on that. But he don't know how to fail. Ask the children of Israel at the Red Sea. Ask Noah. Amen. Amen. Ask the three Hebrew children. Ask Daniel in the lion's den. Ask Paul and Silas. Ask Lazarus the beggar. Ask Jesus at Calvary. The devil thought he had him, didn't he?
Yes, sir.
Overcame death, hell, and the grave. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow.
That's good.
He doesn't know how to fail. Number four, and I'm done. He doesn't know a better time than right now to be saved. Right now. You say, everybody in here is saved. Maybe, maybe not. I don't know your heart. I only know mine. We're talking about dates and all of that. Lord called me to preach a long time before I ever surrendered, but I surrendered in March 8th, 1992. I remember that day, Brother Steve, when I went down there and got down on the altar. And my pastor come down there and put his arm around me and said, is there something I can help you pray about? And I was weeping, and I said, I got to preach. That's all I said. And he just kind of laughed. Why? It was joy. He said, I wondered when you was going to surrender. It used to make me so mad. We had this guy in the church, Brother Smitty. And I'd come out and he'd say, God's going to get you one of these days. God's going to get you one of these days. Oh, it made me so mad. I said, I had one of them sweet spirits one morning. I said, if he does, you'll be the second one to know. I said it kind of ugly, too. Because I'll be the first. Or God be the first, second, third. But today is the day. Right? Because we're not promised tomorrow. And again, going back to the hospital. Do you know there's people over there in the hospital dying right now? Dying right now. I forgot how many people die per year. I looked it up one time. It was in the millions. People die. We don't have any promise of tomorrow. But God doesn't know a better time than tonight for you to get saved if you've never been born again. In that respect, there's some things that God don't know, isn't there? Not in knowledge and all of that. Would you stand? Brother Steve, you come. Thank you for your attention tonight. I appreciate you listening. And I appreciate Brother Josh, your dear pastor, giving me this opportunity. Father, bless now this invitation, I pray. Lord, you've spoken to my heart, and I pray that you've spoken to others. Reminded us of how good that we have it, even though we're not immune from troubles and trials in our life. And we have hard days just like everybody else. But Lord, when we come into the house of God and read your word and sing your songs, we're reminded of the goodness of God and that the best is yet to come. Lord, there's some things that you don't know. Lord, you hate sin. You love sinners. You never failed. You don't know how to fail anybody. And then, Lord, you know that today's the day of salvation. So, God, work in our midst, I pray. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Brother Holly, you come.
Let's keep our heads bowed and eyes closed, if you will. Miss Kelly, Miss Beverly, Brother Frank will play for us tonight. Has God been good to you? I know that I'm way behind on thanking God for his goodness. Just got to be honest with you. If I started thanking the Lord right now and thank God every minute of every hour of every day of every week of every month of every year from now to the rest of my life, I'd never catch up because I'm way behind. God has been good. And then I asked this tonight, as Brother Randy asked, are you saved? I write down 66 most days of my life. There's a church sign there. It's been there for quite a while. I don't know how many years, but the message on the top of the board never changed. It just simply says, are you saved? Every time I ride by that sign, I say, thank you, Lord, for saving me. Are you saved tonight? You could have been in church for 50 years, 60 years, 70 years, 80 years. Still not be saved. Would you come tonight? Would you give up? Would you give in and finally just give your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ? Maybe in the quietness of your seat there, if you're here tonight and you are saved, and maybe you're like Asaph, your heart has got cold. Easy to get cold on God sometimes, isn't it? We get out around the world and the negativity, all the influences, everything that's going on, and our hearts, they turn cold against God. Maybe just in the quietness of your seat tonight, you want to just tell the Lord, Lord, I'm sorry. I'm refreshing. I'm giving my heart to you afresh and anew, and I'm going to wake up tomorrow with a new determination to be thankful, to be grateful, to recognize your goodness, to acknowledge your power and your knowledge, because God sure is good. Father, we thank you for the time you've given us together tonight. Thank you so much for Brother Randy, for the message, how it spoke to my heart. Lord, I'm thankful for your word that has been inspired and has been preserved for us. Lord, I never get tired of hearing it. Lord, I'm thankful that you've got something fresh, you've got something new for us every day, Lord, as we open it and read it and apply it to our life. Every service we come to, Lord, you've got something fresh. You've got something new for us. You've got your servant, Lord, whether it be our pastor or Brother Randy, any guest speaker, whoever it is, Lord, that opens the Word of God, you've got something for us. And I'm thankful, Lord, that we live in a country Though America is straying down a wicked path, Lord, I'm thankful that we still have the privilege to open the Word of God. And Lord, to preach it, to hear it preached, and to sing it. We thank you for your goodness and your power and your love. Lord, as we close the service out tonight, I pray that there's somebody here that's lost and they've never accepted you as their personal Savior. I pray that they wouldn't walk out the doors of this building before they get that settled. And allow you, Lord, allow us to take the Word of God and show them how they can be saved. Thank you for Brother Randy. I pray that you'll be with Miss Pam. Lord, continue to touch her right now. God, I pray that you'd put your hand on her and heal her, Lord. Help her to feel better. Be able to stand by Brother Randy's side as he continues to preach your word. Touch our pastor, Miss Hannah, and bless them in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much for coming tonight, church. You've been such a blessing. It's a great crowd for a Sunday night, and I know that you are an encouragement to our pastor. And so, again, thank you for being here. It looks like we've got more people here tonight than what we had this morning, and that's certainly a blessing. I know that'll be a blessing to our pastor tonight. You continue to pray for him and Miss Hannah, and their children, that God will watch over them, protect them, and keep them safe as well. Pray for Brother Randy and Miss Pam and their ministry there. And then, church, let's pray for one another. You never know what the person beside you is going through, right? We can hide it really well sometimes, but people are carrying burdens. So let's pray for each other and that God will give us a good week as we try to reach out to Austin Dying World, okay? All right, God bless you. You're dismissed. Shake Brother Randy's hand on the way out. We'll see you soon.